Hello, thank you all for coming to my talk post-lunch. Not an easy thing to do. I only had broccoli for lunch, very uncharacteristic, but it's going to keep me spry. So my name is Matt Surabian. I work at Zipcar. Our home office is right here in Boston. That's Andy. We are hiring. So if you think any of this stuff I'm about to talk about is cool, you should talk to him, not me. Zipcar was among the first IoT platforms. It started 7 years before the iPhone was invented. We currently have over 1 million customers across 10 countries. And Cloud Foundry and Bosh tooling really helped us to standardize across all of our public and private data centers. That's been huge. We've been using Cloud Foundry in production for about 3 years now, which you may have heard from Andy if you caught any of the keynotes. And also, if you caught any of my colleagues talk, like Jason, who is here, and Derek, you know, you may have seen these stats. What running in production means for us is that we have over 25 production environments. Between dev and prod, we have over 6,000 containers running right now, kind of a lot. Our engineers control their own application release cycles. They release code every day of the week, all the time. And if you're laughing right now, I know you have bad taste in jokes and you read slides. So let's talk secrets. These are the things we think about when we're talking about secrets, right? If you've seen any other secrets talks here, you've probably seen this list many, many times. We want to keep these things secret. There's some big pile of secrets that an application needs, some subset we need at runtime, some subset we need during deploy time, and we also want infrastructure as code. And those things fight, right? So what are we going to do? We're going to store them somewhere secure when we're not using them. But as a result of doing that, secrets are going to end up kind of in plain text on our stack, right? We're going to try to restrict access to them, but we still need them at some point. So we're going to use a templating solution, or we're going to find ways to inject them into the environment. But you know, that's not ideal when your clicker dies. Very, very bad. Hold on. Yes. So we inject them into our environment, right? CFNV, you may have heard about that at some security talks. You can see all the secrets that some container needs. That's painful. CFDOT is even worse. If you're in a Diego cell and you check out the state of your cell, you're going to see every container in that cell's secrets because they live in the environment. When you get a scheduler involved, of course, your scheduler, in this case, Diego, or if you're on Kubernetes, right, something else, is going to need your secrets to inject into the environment. And so it's going to persist it in its own data store so that when your scheduler wants to heal your infrastructure or scale you up or deploy a new thing, it's going to stick that stuff in the environment for you. Very helpful, also a little scary. Or you're going to do something clever, and you're going to say, well, I'm not going to put secrets in my environment. Instead, I'm going to give it something that's going to let it auth to my super secret store. But in order to auth to your secret store, you need to give it something to auth with, which is also a secret. And so that's a pain. It means that we're transiting secrets through multiple pieces of our platform, and that's turtles all the way down, right? James Hunt referred to it as the secret zero problem. So I don't have tons of time, so instead I want to do threat modeling with really big and broad strokes. On a scale of script kiddie to the Mossad, with an incompetent or malicious employee landing right in the middle, what is our major concern? So I'm guessing that because you're at this talk, which is about managing container secrets at scale, you're all comfortable setting up a network perimeter, firewall rules, right, role-based access credentials, VPNs, auditable authentication. You know who's in there and what they're doing. Congratulations. You're safe from, you know, wares from the 90s and script kiddies trolling on the internet, probably. Probably most of you are here. You think your coworkers are kind of cool, right? Like, they wouldn't do anything crazy, like leave their unencrypted laptop on a bus. You know, they're not going to do something nuts like publish, I don't know, classified information into a publicly available S3 bucket. That's never happened. And so we trust them, and we trust the way that they work. And we're going to put in internal authorization levels so that we limit the number of people who can do the inside job. And that's cool. The problem is that if you can't detect or resist that incompetent or malicious employee, you probably cannot detect or resist a modern attack. Because at a certain point, that modern and sophisticated attack breaks through all your script kiddie level safety, and it's in your network. And now you can't tell the difference between that attack and that malicious employee. And so this is a great time to stop and ask ourselves, why do I care? Oh my God. Right? Like, you want to talk to me about secure introduction? Like, I got default passwords over there. So, you know, solving secure introduction is only really a problem if you have secrets to protect and you understand your threat model. So nobody's going to come attack your super secret protection architecture if everything else isn't sorted out first. So basically what I'm saying is, if you're not sure you need this, you probably don't need this. It's not fun. Secret management is not like something you're going to do for funsies and a hobby. I think it's fun because I'm insane. Secrets don't make friends. That's a saying for a reason. So if you think you need this, it's probably because you've got regulatory requirements, right? Like, somebody is going to be looking at you if you leak secrets. So here's where we want to get. We can't resist the NSA or the Mossad or some state actor with unlimited compute, unlimited funds, spy satellites that we don't have. But we can probably resist a malicious employee. That'd be nice. And you know, anybody can get zero-dayed. There's all kinds of bugs out there that people are just sitting on that nobody knows about. And so all your cool security checking is not going to catch it because nobody knows about it. It's not worth saying. What we're saying is, wouldn't it be nice if we could design a system where we're not trusting nobody ever, we're just shy of trusting nobody ever? How do we get there? I think there's two keys. The first is expiring trust. Yeah, I'm going to trust my machines, I'm going to trust my employees, but I'm going to put some kind of onus on them to consistently prove that they're actually worthy of that trust. And you know, my key here is, like, if you're going to implement automated credential rotation, or you're going to swap out your certs, you're going to swap out your keys, delete the old ones. You can laugh, but like, credential rotation is actually really hard to do. And there's a lot of funky and annoying edge cases that can cause you to leave those old credentials around. And if you do that for a few hours or days, it's probably not a problem. But like, I'm sure some of you have looked into a credential rotation scheme and gone like, oh my God, we've got 6 months of old credentials here. Not good. You'd be so much better off if you never did that, because then you'd know the state of the situation. There's one secret, and as long as it didn't leak, I'm probably good, and when I rotate it, I'm doing it manually, and oh, it's so painful, but like, it really is rotated. The other one is, we want to keep our eyes on people and things. We want a system where if our secrets are compromised, it's relatively easy and quick to find out in some way. We have some options. We don't have to do this ourselves. Some of these may sound familiar. Committing secrets, baking them into your base image or your base container, injecting them into the environment, kind of the status quo, or fetching them at runtime. So three of these things fall just shy of resisting your inside job, and one of them is slightly better. And I think the thing to remember is, like, it's still totally a valid strategy to shrink the group of people who have access to that giant pile of secrets. That is totally fine, because this stuff is hard, and doing it wrong is way worse than not doing it at all. So, committing secrets, don't make me talk about this. You know, oh yeah, laugh. You're doing it. I know you're doing it. I promised myself I'm not going to get upset, so I'm also not going to talk about baking secrets into a base image. I want to talk about this, injecting them into the environment. This is where we're at today. There have been some cool talks that show how you don't necessarily have to do this anymore, and we'll get into that in a minute. Just a reminder, the environment can be seen by every process. Friendly and hostile. If you have a developer that writes an angry application that logs your environment to a log or a server or an S3 bucket, that's bad. Your environment ending up in logs is really bad for two reasons. One, it's like, oh my God, it's in the logs. And two, because you're lowering that technical barrier, right? I'm going to restrict access to my jump box. I'm going to restrict access to my containers. And nobody can get into my system. Are you restricting access to your Kibana logs or Elasticsearch? Probably not, because somebody who's going to like debug this stuff needs to go in there, and they might not have that same level of access as that tight-knit group of people. And so if I can, like, Lucene queries are hard, right? But they're not so hard that I can't put one together that says, like, PG password, right? Like, that's not that bad. If I want to go a little bit closer to state actor level, I can say that my hypervisor and my scheduler both have access to my container's environment. And so that means that if there were ever 0 days on those, all my creds would get leaked. And we already talked about how rotation is a pain. So fine, great. I've convinced you, I can tell, we want to fetch them at runtime. But how are we going to do that? MTLS, very popular, super awesome. A secret that lets us get other secrets, we know that's bad. Whitelisting with network information, it's not so bad. I think it's like a base level, right? Like, is this request coming from a place that it should come from? We should be asking that question. It's like low-hanging security fruit. It keeps you safe from script kiddies, not from a malicious modern attack. So this is the secure introduction problem. When something requests credentials at runtime, why do I trust that request at all? And if I do trust that request, how am I going to get them the credentials in the first place? So we only have two options. There's probably more, but these are the two, I mean, I'm not going to talk about any more today. CredHub and Vault. Vault has some downsides. Oh, I love Vault, but oh, man. If you've never worked with a Vault server, it can be challenging. There's a lot of tricky things. There's a safe release. It can make that easier. And it can easily become a snowflake or single point of failure. And that's pain. There's no built-in Bosh support. There's things like Spruce that can help. There's other third-party tools that can help us, but there's nothing built in. There's lots of auth options, but they need to be manually configured, which can also be kind of tricky and get you close to that snowflake state, maybe. And the seal and unseal behavior people usually hate. I just restarted, I just redeployed Vault, and like, ugh, it's sealed, and I have to wake somebody up at 2 in the morning to unseal it. I think that is a feature, and you can bother me about that later. I don't get those pings, by the way. So Vault is also awesome at a lot of things. It has granular breakcast support. It has parent-child token relationships, and that means that if I have a child token that is doing this awesome second bullet thing of generating dynamic secrets for me from tons of external services, like, I can revoke that parent token, and all the other credentials get revoked for me. I don't care what they are. I don't know what they are, right? That's awesome. It also has lots of built-in auth options, even though you have to manually configure them. There's tons of them. Super cool. I say zero downtime credential rotation is solved. There are lots of tools in the Vault ecosystem that make this easier. It does require some onus on app developers to solve this, right? If your app is going to pull from the environment to read credentials or going to pull from some other place to read credentials and it only does that at boot time, well, probably going to have to reboot your app, which might be some downtime. And we can talk about ways to solve that. It does have built-in concourse support. So if you do a lot of things with concourse, like we do at Zipcar, your life can be much easier. Vault also has mindshare both in and out of the CF community. So just like all open source software, while you're sleeping, Vault is getting better. Vault has detailed audit logs and tons of places you can ship those logs to, which is great. Vault is FIPS compliant, which if, I don't know, is that a concern for anybody here? Congratulations, that's great. The mess. Not a concern for me either, but they will give you a letter that says they are FIPS compliant. You can show that to a lawyer and you are set. Vault also has multiple backend storage options, right? Vault really wants to function as a dumb host. So Vault doesn't want your data, Vault doesn't want your secrets, it's gonna pass it through and encrypt it somewhere else. That's nice. CredHub has tons of benefits too. Thanks to Diego, CredHub can do MTLS auth for you. This slide used to be much different, by the way, and I had to rewrite this talk after I went to a bunch of talks here, and that was kind of stressful for me. But I have a lot of nice things to say now. So MTLS auth is done for you, right? Diego's going to give you a cert, and as I recently found out, you can have Diego rotate that cert constantly for you, up to every hour. That's amazing. That kind of solves your problem, right? It also integrates with UAA, so people can auth into it, which is nice. It has built-in support for Bosh. It has built-in support for Concourse. And if you've been following CredHub development at all, when they first announced CredHub and its integration with Surface Brokers, there was a bit of a security concern that some of us in the community had that we were passing those credentials through tons of components, and it wasn't very secure. Like, why can't the apps just talk to CredHub? And since this spring, they've solved that, which is awesome. It's another example of an active open source project getting better while you're sleeping. CredHub also has a detailed audit log. Currently, it's only in MySQL, which can be a problem, but that is changing. It also has Spring CredHub integration. So if you're using Spring, CredHub is an awesome option for you. It has some downsides. It does not yet have anything like parent-child token relationships or automatic expiration via TTL, which is painful. It means you have to do it Or you have to figure out a way to rotate credentials without downtime, or at least with minimal downtime, because CredHub is really right now relying on that fixed path. I have to request a path. If some of my containers have a certain cred and some of them have another one, when do I expire the old ones? And these are the fun edge cases that come when you have to implement credential rotation. Mindshare is also, right now at least, confined to the CF community. So if you're using all CF or mostly CF, that's great. CredHub is probably the option you want to go with. It does not yet have dynamic secret generation like Vault does. So it can't generate and expire credentials for you from third-party locations. Maybe not a problem for you. It's not yet integrated with CFCR. That's on the roadmap. There's only one storage backend, as I mentioned. There's only one audit backend, which is also MySQL. So that can cause pain points. They're able to be worked around. And like I said, smart people working on this, this is going to get better. How do we choose? So, like I said, if you're already using CredHub today and you don't have any of those concerns that I outlined, you should keep using CredHub. If you're using Vault today and you want to answer this question, is it possible to authenticate with a secret service without first seeding an app with a golden secret? What do you think? Let's talk about my favorite software. Yeah! All right. I already talked to you about all the awesome things that Vault can generate and expire secrets for. This is a small list of those things. There's infrastructure providers, there's services, there's things you can run yourself, there's things that can be hosted elsewhere. And it also has really cool security primitives. I would love to see these things integrated in CredHub or any other security software. They're so awesome. Periodic tokens, response wrapping, and the cubbyhole backend. Has anybody in here used one of these or more? Yes, yes, talk to me, awesome. If you haven't, let's review them. Okay, typical Vault tokens have a renewal time and a maximum lifetime. And so that means that you're using it and you can use it for so long and you could say you want it some more, but eventually it's gonna go away. And that can be sad, especially for long-running applications and containers. Periodic tokens do not have a max lifetime. But usually what you do is you set a very short renewal time called the period on it. So you might set that to 10 minutes, 5 minutes, 30 seconds if you're crazy. And as long as whatever's using that token is calling out to Vault and saying, I am still using this token, that token will live forever. Very cool. You can also associate these periodic tokens with parent tokens, which can also be periodic tokens themselves. And if you revoke the parent token, all of its child tokens are revoked, even if it's being renewed. And the same goes for any periodic token. If you have the assessor to it, you can revoke it, even if it's being renewed. Response wrapping is probably the closest thing that we're going to get to those self-destructing spy messages you see in, Get Smart or Mission Impossible or, Inspector Gadget, which was the Get Smart guy again, Don Adams. And this is built into Vault. This requires no special configuration. It has a flag. So when you do a Vault read, like that one there, you just pass a flag, wrap TTL, and give it a time. That's instead of giving you back the secret that you just requested, it's going to give you back a token that kind of looks like a GUID. And that can fetch a single secret one time within that specified amount of time. And that is so cool, I'm going to say it so many times. You get a single secret one time within a specified amount of time. After you read it, useless. If the time expires, useless. Instead of issuing a read, you issue an unwrap. And this is really cool because I don't know where that secret is coming from. See, the read has my path in it. The unwrap does not. Very awesome. Cubbyhole. This is a private scoped key value store. Each token has their own. No other token, including the root token, can do anything with another token's cubbyhole. You don't even know if there's anything in it. You can do nothing with it. When that token is destroyed, whether it's revoked, expired, doesn't matter, everything inside the cubbyhole goes away. To use it, all you do is you write something to cubbyhole slash instead of secret slash. That's it. Let's put this all together. If you're a big fan of Dwayne The Rock Johnson, as I am, or you have children, you may have seen this scene. It is Maui inside the movie Moana jumping into the realm of monsters, and that is what we are going to do. So let's do this. Okay. You probably remember from just a few short minutes ago that in order to use secrets at runtime, the app needs to authenticate to Vault and get a Vault token some way. We're going to say it needs a username and password. This could be an MTLS cert. It could be a couple of other things. App roles are very common ways for machines to authenticate with Vault. So that's what we're going to go with for this example. But this could be anything. So in order to do that, we're going to need to give it a role ID, which is not so secret, and a secret ID. And we can't just give it to it, right? We need to conceal it in some way, give it some cover, hold to those two things we talked about in the beginning of this talk. Frequent credential rotation. Clean up the old stuff. Watching. Does this sound like anything? It should sound like these two features. Cubbyhole gives us a secret place. Nobody else can read it unless they've compromised your token. Response wrapping gives us a single-use token that is able to fetch a single secret one time within a specified amount of time. And the corollary to that is that if something else reads it, and you try to read it, oops, that's bad, and you try to read it, and you can't, something else did. That's pretty cool. That's this. I tried to read it, I couldn't, something else did. Very awesome. Wow, look at that. Oof. All right, we're gonna do this in a couple of pieces. So first, actually, let's start here, right? This orchestration API. This could be a service broker, could be anything, right? This could be an external service outside of Cloud Foundry. You need something that is kind of a snowflake. You probably already have this if you're using Vault. That orchestration API is going to generate a periodic token, probably under a parent token that we scope in some granular level that where it makes us happy for revocation. We're going to inject that token into every application instance, the same way we inject stuff into the environment. And you say, wait, you're injecting a secret. No, because this token cannot do anything inside Vault. All it can access is its own cubbyhole. Okay, so what? So now our orchestration API server is going to generate a secret user ID for the application to use. But it's not going to read it like a monster. It's going to get it as a wrapped response. And so what it's going to get back is something that can only be read once. And it's going to stick it in that injected token's cubbyhole. So it's using its weakness as a strength. It has to keep that injected token around to reboot these applications. It has to keep that injected token in its environment. And so we're going to put stuff in that injected token's cubbyhole that is valid for such a small amount of time that if it's ever disclosed, good luck. So at boot time, the application is going to read that injected token from its environment, and it's going to loop through the entry in its cubbyhole. And if it finds one, that's awesome. It now has its username and password. So it can go about its business and get a negotiated token and start working with Vault. It's not going to do anything crazy, like write that negotiated token back out to the environment or to disk or to S3. It's going to just keep it in memory. And if it loops through the whole array and it can't find a wrapped response token that's valid, it is going to freak out. We're going to ping people. We're going to revoke the parent token. We're going to do some measured thing. Or we're in dev, and we're going to tweak our timeout because it happens. It happens. Once the app is running, we have everything we need, right? We have that token that's in our environment that's now useless because we've read everything out of that array. So nothing of value there. Read my environment. I don't care. And we have the negotiated token, which is really important. We're going to keep in our memory. And we're going to poll Vault with both those things and say, hey, I'm using this, I'm using this, I'm using this. And that's going to help us out so that those things don't expire. And remember, when they do expire, whether we do it or whether your app crashes or whether you just shut down this whole deployment and all the apps are gone, all of the secrets that they requested from those dynamic secrets backends go with them. So I don't have to worry about like, oh my God, where are those even? They're gone. Vault does that for me. So one more time for people that like diagrams like this. I want to deploy two instances of an application. I talk to my orchestration API, talks to Vault, makes a periodic token for me. Maybe it's going to make a parent and store the assessor so that we can do revocations on some granular level. And you have a little control here, right? It might be app basis, it might be org basis, it might be space basis, whatever you want. Then it's going to request a wrap response for the secret thing that whatever you're talking about needs to authenticate to Vault, and it's going to stick that in the cubbyhole. Then Diego is going to do its normal thing. We're going to stick that into the environment manifest. We're going to put it somewhere else. We're going to get it into our application's environment, usually via Diego. And now our app's going to read that out of its environment, loop through its cubbyhole, see what's there, hopefully read something. If it doesn't, this is our break glass, right? This is where we would stop and do something to notify somebody and revoke credentials. Assuming it finds it, it's going to then be able to authenticate to Vault. It's going to say, hey, can you actually give me a real token now, please? And it's going to do that. And then it can just talk to Vault. And it can go provision its secrets. It can do anything it would normally do with Vault. And you can set roles all along the way, right? Like, it doesn't have to have full free reign to Vault. You can namespace its paths. You can mount custom backends for your services. You can do whatever you want. Once the app's running, one, it is going to communicate to Vault and do its normal thing, requesting credentials. Now, here's the cool part, right? I said automatic credential rotation was solved. So what I mean by that is if you were to develop something in your applications or a shared piece of code across all your applications, like an SDK or just a library that you want to share to connect to these things, you could probably do it in a service broker too. You'd say, okay, I want to use these creds, and your app is going to get the creds, and it's going to start using them. And it's going to implement a small retry loop. It's going to go out, it's going to try to communicate with these things to run a query, right, on Postgres, say. And if it can't, instead of just crashing and failing and being scared, it's going to go, hold on, let me try to negotiate new credentials with that same secrets backend, which it should be able to do because it already has a negotiated token to auth to Vault to generate as many creds as it wants. Vault's expired my Postgres credentials because I was really like nice and I wrote a role that made sure that my dynamic backend was expiring my credentials every 30 minutes or something wild, making security people so happy. And then my application is going to get new creds and keep going on with its life. And so that's not bad. That gives us credential rotation. We don't have to have any downtime. We just have a little retry loop. And of course, if it can't do that, then we probably don't need to trigger break glass, but we might want to crash the app. And crashing the app, depending on how many instances there are, will cause that beginning large diagram to happen again. If a single app instance crashes, this is what's going to happen. We're going to listen to that crash event, number one, which we can do, right? Diego emits events that say something just crashed. We listen to that. Number two, we reach out to Vault and we say, hey, I need a new wrapped response for secret ID. It's going to put that back in the cubbyhole. Number three, it's going to be injected back into the environment. Fine. Number four, it's going to go out to Vault. It's going to loop through that array. And because in number two, I already put the thing in the cubbyhole for it, it's going to find it. Or it's not. We're going to freak out. If it does, then number five is going to go about its business as it was when the app was running fine. There's two risks that I can think about here. The first I kind of touched on a little, right? Something reads the cubbyhole. It's problematic, but only for a very small amount of time. And if you're aggressive with your credential rotations, you're making it really hard. Like, yeah, I exfiltrated those creds, and now I want to go use them, but maybe they're not valid because they have a really short TTL. Kind of nice. And most of the time, unless you have an adversary who can, like, willfully crash your apps and keep them crashed before something else in your monitoring catches, like, huh, this app that communicates with Postgres has been down for couple hours now and it keeps going down. I mean, something should notify you that something's not quite right there, right? The second risk is that something compromises an application's periodic token. It does something reckless, writes to disk, something can like debug your app in real time and get out of its active memory, whatever that token is. That's kind of bad, because we wouldn't know. But if we use Concourse or something cool to redeploy our applications regularly, and part of that redeployment was going through and revoking the parent token that we created at the very beginning of this that has never left our orchestration API, all those creds would be revoked for us. So again, we haven't totally solved it, because maybe it can't be solved, but we've significantly increased the difficulty. And like, there is always an easier target in the enterprise space especially. So I think, that is my modest proposal for how we can solve this. If any of that seems like too much, there's always legacy technology that you can use to keep yourself safe. miraculously, I think we have maybe time for one question or a couple more, and you can harangue me in the back about Vault literally the rest of the night. Any questions? Oh, so easy. Great. Thank you so much for coming to my talk. I'll hang around back there, and I love really talking about this because I don't know why, but I just do.